My name's Alan Maki. I'm the director of organizing for the Midwest Casino Workers Organizing Council. I work in Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Michigan with casino workers that are trying to organize unions in the Indian gaming industry. I initially came to the attention of the FBI back in 1963 when I was 12 years old for participating in an anti-Vietnam War demonstration at that time, a very early anti-war demonstration, with a group of Quakers that was organized by the Communist Party Club in Grand Rapids, Michigan. And people often ask me, well, why were you targeted by the FBI? Well, that really shouldn't be a question for me to have to answer. The FBI should have to answer that question. This isn't just about me. This is about what the FBI has done to millions of people in this country that have been active in the anti-war movement, the civil rights movement, the labor movements, and the environmental movements. In other words, the FBI goes after anybody that tries to make life better for the majority of the people in this country. We saw what they did to the Occupy movement. They sent over 500 FBI agents into the Occupy movement to disrupt the Occupy movement. You know, this blatantly trampling on the constitutional rights of the American people. And this kind of crap has to end. And the only way it's going to end is if people start to request their files so we actually see what's going on in this country. The FBI, they pretty, you know, you don't have to believe what I say about why the FBI investigated me. I have files, there's files there in front of Nathan. Those files were obtained in a lawsuit. Back in 1974, 75, and 76, 14 people in the state of Michigan thought they had files being kept on them by the Michigan State Police and the FBI, so they filed a lawsuit in the Ingham County Circuit Court before Judge Thomas Brown, asking for their files and that the files be destroyed. A lady named Lee Beckett, who was active in the American Civil Liberties Union at that time, she came to me and she says, well, geez, if these people got files on them, you must have a massive file for all the activities you've been involved in. And so I went through the procedure of requesting my file. I then became one of the plaintiffs in this lawsuit. After I became a plaintiff, we brought in over 400 people who became plaintiffs in this lawsuit against the Michigan State Police, and we asked that the Red Squads be disbanded. The Red Squads are squads involving the FBI, the State Police here in Minnesota. It would be the Public Safety Commission, the Highway Patrol, local sheriff's departments, city police. These are what constitute the Red Squads. When they come together, and they start investigating people and infiltrating these organizations to try and disrupt them. And that's what they're trying to do, disrupt. It's not just compiling records on people. They're trying to disrupt the movements of the American people from struggling for justice against Wall Street is what it amounts to. And so it's a very proactive type investigation that they're conducting. And they say in their own documents, this here is a letter from the director of the FBI, and it was signed by J. Edgar Hoover. In my files, I have documents that authorized the FBI to investigate me signed by every single director of the FBI. And this states here, and this is very important, this investigation is based on information which indicates that the captioned subject is engaged in activities which could involve a violation of Title 18 United States Code 2385, advocating the overthrow of the government, 2383, rebellion or insurrection, 2384, seditious conspiracy, or Title 50, United States Code 781-810, Internal Security Act of 1950, and the Communist Control Act of 1954. Now think of this. You know, here in this country, we had a Communist Control Act. Its primary author, a lot of people don't know this, but the primary author of the Communist Control Act of 1954 was one Hubert H. Humphrey. Wow. And, you know, so Humphrey was working hand-in-hand with Joe McCarthy in these days. And the communist, when you think about the Communist Control Act, we're supposed to be living in the world's greatest bastion of democracy here in the United States of America. But you have a Communist Control Act. What does that mean? People are being investigated and spied on and harassed because of their political beliefs for being communist. What is a communist? You know, I have things up here. This is what a communist is. These are the things I've been involved in. I've been involved in the peace movement. I stood up and told Nixon to go fight his own dirty war. You know, there's all kinds of documents in these files about that. I was involved in the civil rights movement. I went to the high school in Grand Rapids, Michigan, Union High School. It was the first high school that was integrated in the northern United States, and there was a lot of problems. Black students and myself, we were beat up and harassed by the state police, the Grand Rapids Police Department, and, you know, right-wing racist. So, you know, and then the police report on all this. And to just give you an idea how they report on this, this is a document from January 14th, 1969, and it's from the Detective Division of the Grand Rapids, Michigan Police Department, and it's to Detective Richard M. Shave, the Michigan State Police Intelligence. That's the Red Squads. It says, "Dear Dick, Bill Pettiford turned this report over to me to get your information. Telephone number 245-1995 is listed to Robert LeBaron of 504 Umatilla Southeast. I can find nothing on Mr. LeBaron. However, it might be of some interest to know that he lives in the Negro area. He apparently is the publisher and publishes this paper in his home. Telephone number 453-3668 is listed to Armis I. Mackey of 1854 Street Northwest. Alan Maki, 17 years, is the son of Armis and lives at the same address. Alan is known to our people to be the youngest known card-carrying communist in Grand Rapids. He is one of the young men who gave us so much trouble at Union High School." And this is very important because I was a member of the NAACP Youth Council, and it was this youth council that served as the catalyst to propel this lawsuit against the Grand Rapids Board of Education, in which a federal judge ordered the integration because the schools were so segregated, just like they were in Mississippi. So our youth council took a leading role in these young people who were high school age. They said, you know, hey, we got the right to go to quality public schools that are integrated schools. And the NAACP filed a lawsuit on our behalf. And as a result of that, there was this court case. And here you have, this letter was signed, sincerely, William A. Johnson, Superintendent of Police, Grand Rapids, Michigan. So here you have the chief of police in Michigan's second largest city saying that that I and others gave him so much trouble. And the trouble was that we insisted that our school be integrated. That was the trouble. Nothing was ever said about the racists coming out with baseball bats and football helmets beating us up, or the police. I was charged with assaulting a police officer. Outright lies. And they said I assaulted five police officers. And it just so happened that a TV cameraman from the Wood TV News took pictures of the whole thing. And they refused to bring that into the court. I was convicted and sentenced to 7 years in Jackson Penitentiary in Michigan. We appealed that. Several of the students, they actually served some prison time until we were able to get this footage from the news media out into the public. My attorney and some black ministers took over a city council meeting in Grand Rapids, Michigan and showed the movie. And not only did it show that we were innocent, it showed the police beating us up. So, you know, these are the kinds of things that go on. And the FBI was in constant contact with the prosecutor, pushing them to prosecute us for these charges that were very malicious and fraudulent to start with.
Alan, we got a question over here.
Yeah, I just wanted to know, what year was that?
That letter was 1969. Then to show how they work, you know, if anybody thinks that these are just information gathering things that are going on, just totally wrong. This here is a record about Reggie Gatling. He was the head of what they called the Kentfield Foundation, which was to help troubled youth. And because Reggie Gatling and I, we did some radio programs and wrote some articles in newspapers and stuff, the FBI targeted him and they shut down his program. And it says here, information we received from a reliable source of the involvement of Reggie Gatling of the Kentfield Foundation and Alan Maki. Source stated that he came across information from another source that Gatling spoke at Forest Hills High School, Key Club, and present at the speech was Alan Maki. Maki passed out literature pertaining to the Students for a Democratic Society. And this becomes very important too, the Students for a Democratic Society. I was involved in the Students for a Democratic Society, just like tens of thousands of other students across this country. Well, I guess what was unique about my involvement is that I was also a member of the Communist Party. And the FBI, they were trying to build the case that my involvement in the Communist Party was to channel funds and stuff from Moscow into the youth organizations in this country. This was actually stated before a Senate Internal Security Committee meeting. And, you know, they had no information to back it up, but they put my picture in, along with about 50 other people in the New York Times, and that picture, and then that was published in the New York Times, saying that we were responsible for all the trouble in this country. About, you know, anti-Vietnam War demonstrations and everything.
Strong work.
And this is related to today because the guy that worked for the Senate Internal Security Committee, he now works for a guy named Richard Mellon Scaife. Richard Mellon Scaife is a very wealthy billionaire in this country from the steel industry. The Mellons made their money in from banking. He's from Pennsylvania. And Mr. Scaife is funding an outfit called AIM, Accuracy in Media. And if you look on the internet, there's an outfit called KeyWiki. And KeyWiki has received all kinds of information, all these files that we had to fight for through the courts. The FBI and the Justice Department has just turned all this stuff over to these people. And they've turned it over to these people through another outfit called Altegrity USIS. Altegrity USIS is like a quasi-governmental organization, and it's a quasi-governmental organization because it employs former and current, you might say, off-duty FBI agents and CIA agents. And this outfit, USIS, started in Hollywood, Florida, to protect the Indian gaming industry, and then it combined with this Altegrity. So now it's Altegrity USIS. And they've gotten all these records, and if you look at KeyWiki, and these guys have set up this outfit that works out of New Zealand. They've set up their in New Zealand so that we can't touch them through the courts here in this country. Richard Mellon Scaife sent me an email and said, because my attorney threatened to sue him for misinformation they had put on there about me. And he said, good luck, I hope you have real deep pockets. And so, you know, in order to sue this outfit, you'd have to probably start suing in New Zealand. You know, this is the way they're operating. The amazing thing is they've associated Mark Dayton with the Communist Party here in Minnesota. They said that Mark Ritchie is openly collaborating with the Communist Party of Minnesota because he participated in some meeting with the Communist Party at Mayday Books. This is all on the internet. And they do this to politicians in every single state. And they said that Alan Maki is a top official in the Minnesota DFL. At one time, I was a member of the State Central Committee of the DFL. So they put all these things together and weave their little stories to make it look like there's this big communist conspiracy. People think that this is from the days gone by, but it's not. This is going on today. This is the kind of thing that the John Birch Society has been involved in for years, but now it's been taken to a whole new level where government agencies like the FBI and the Justice Department are feeding this information to these private detective agencies who then take this information and pass it along to these right-wing outfits and do these dirty deeds. And people should check all this out to see for themselves. And getting back to Reggie Gatlin here, he was a very well-known guy that worked with young people that were having a lot of problems in prison and everything else. The Kent Fields program was one of the best programs in the country. It was featured in Life magazine because the rate of kids going back into crime was literally zero. And because they got together with this Donald Zerio, who was an assistant prosecuting attorney in Kent County, and Bob Blanford, who was a county commissioner, and Gerald Ford at the time, who was a congressman, they shut off funding for the Kent Fields rehabilitation program. And they openly state in this letter because of his association with me. So, you know, this is not something where they're just collecting information to put it in a book and save it. They're using this information to do these kinds of dirty deeds to people.
What was that word you said? Alternate?
Altegrity.
Oh, that's such a funny word.
Oh, that's what they call it. They have a real interesting website if you look at it, altegrity.com/USIS. And it's one of the largest detective agencies in the world. They've been involved with fingering people that have been killed in Iraq and the labor movement and everything else. That's the kind of outfit this is. And what essentially what the government is doing is they're putting all this, they're privatizing these kinds of dirty deeds so that people can't come back and sue the government. You know, you try and find out who is doing this from these outfits, and it's almost impossible to find out. We found out there was the guy that, so they call him a special agent from USIS, Altegrity USIS, his name is George Armstrong. He's the one that's been leading the so-called assault on our organizing efforts here in Minnesota. And he actually went took a group of thugs up to Winnipeg and threatened my daughter while she was pregnant. And the RCMP threw these people out of the country. These are just openly, you know, you were talking about mercenaries and stuff, that's what these people are. They claim that they just do research for corporations and stuff for hiring practices. And, you know, for years, you know, people says, oh, you're paranoid, do you think your telephone's tapped and everything? But I have hundreds of documents like this. Well, you see it comes with stuff blacked out, but these are telephone calls, who called me, who I called. And in a lot of cases in the files, you can go through them yourself. There's the actual conversations that I had with people. One was a recording of the head of the Kent County Labor Council and the Michigan AFL-CIO. They recorded our conversations. There was another conversation recorded between myself and Jimmy Hoffa in the airport in Detroit. And so, you know, you wonder how they get all this stuff, you know, and but they have their ways. You know, how does it happen that the FBI is able to record a telephone conversation in an airport in Detroit? Unbelievable, but yet they did. But remember, they said that they were conducting the investigations because of the Communist Control Act. When I sued them in federal court after we won the state court case, I sued them, and William Steele Sessions, who was then the director of the FBI, responded to my complaint, and he said, plaintiff admits that he is a communist. Thus, any reasonable FBI agent would not have concluded that merely investigating plaintiff constituted an unlawful act. And so what, you know, they're making it very clear. They can investigate anybody for their political beliefs, and that's all that they've investigated me for. You know, here I am, I've been investigated by their own record since 1973, and I'm walking around free. I have been arrested 60 or 70 times in this country for things like, you know, real dangerous things. I was arrested 3 times in 1 day for spitting on a sidewalk during a strike in Benton Harbor, Michigan. I was arrested for putting a bumper sticker on the door at the federal building for destruction of U.S. government property the day I was inducted into the U.S. military that said, we want jobs, not war. You know, so I'm a dangerous criminal. And, you know, that's the extent of my arrest record, things like that, petty things where they just arrested me because they wanted to arrest me. I was arrested for painting on a house that they had the bulldozers ready to knock down that said, money for housing, not for war. They arrested me for destruction of government property. And the FBI insisted that they keep pressing those charges with the county prosecutor for over 2 years. You know, how can you destroy something that's going to be knocked down by a bulldozer because you take some spray paint and put on it, money for housing and not for war? But this is the kind of things, you know, that I've been arrested for. They say in some of these documents, they actually complain that I was a model citizen, except for my political beliefs. You know, so this is the kind of government we got. And I make the remark all the time that we have a very rotten government based on the things that have been done to me. And it's not just me, these files, they admitted to the United States District Court Judge Richard Ensland, the United States Attorney admitted that they had a file of over 50,000 pages on me. And the reason that it's 50,000 pages is because most of it isn't even about me. It's about people that I've associated with. And then they go and investigate those people. And what do they do to those people? The same thing that they've done with me. So, you know, this is a very wide repression that's going on in this country. It's political repression. We talk about the world's greatest democracy, but this is what's going on. And our tax dollars are funding this crap. Just imagine how much it costs to accumulate a dossier, like with all this information, tapping people's telephones. I was targeted for 24-hour surveillance for almost 2 years. You know, what does that cost? It's you know, the epitome of, it's just total absurdity that this is going on in this country and people allow this to go on. And we shouldn't.
4 minutes.
Yeah.
How do you finally get your FBI files?
Well, what you have to do, initially you have to make a Freedom of Information Act request. That's on the internet. I would advise everybody to do that. And what you'll get back is a letter from the Department of Justice saying that, sorry, we can't find your file or any file on you. Do you have a reason to believe that we're keeping a file on you? So then you have to, you know, if you've been at a demonstration where the police have been taking your pictures and stuff, then you say that. And then for years they denied having a file on me. And until this court case came out in Michigan. And it was very strange because I was one of the leading plaintiffs in the case demanding that the files be turned over to all the people rather than being destroyed. And so the judge asked for 3 files to be brought to the courtroom, this Judge Thomas Brown. I mean, you gotta imagine, here's a Republican judge sitting there looking at all this. He more or less just said from the very beginning, you know, I don't believe any of this stuff. So he says, but I'll let you have your day in court. Go ahead and proceed. So finally, he said to the Michigan Attorney General, Frank Kelly, who was sitting him personally in his courtroom, he says, Frank, do you have files on these people? And Frank Kelly says, yes, Your Honor. He says, well, can you show me some of these files? And he says, which files would you like to see? The judge says, I'd like to see Jimmy Hoffa's file, Coleman Young's file. Coleman Young, at that time, was a Michigan State Senator who later became mayor of Detroit, and Alan Maki's file. So he told us to come back to court, that they were bringing the files to court. And so the police come in, the state police, and the people from the attorney's office, and they have these factory carts with these 4 wheels and the big stakes on the sides, and they have a truck, and they're unloading all this stuff. And the judge says, well, what is this? And he says, well, you asked for the files. And they find the files that they brought in. Coleman Young's file was about this high, and it wasn't even the complete file. And Jimmy Hoffa's was about the same, and mine was a little one about like this. And that's about half of it right there. And he says, how many people did you do this to? And he just turned beet red, the Attorney General, Frank Kelly from the state of Michigan, he turned beet red and he says, about 55,000 people, Your Honor. And the judge says, Jesus Christ, Frank, what did you do to these people? He just blurted this out. And I mean, this is a straight-laced Republican. You never would have imagined him saying this. But the courtroom that they were using was the city council room in Lansing, Michigan, because the courtrooms are all too small because we had so many plaintiffs. And he just blurted out, Jesus Christ, Frank, what did you do to these people? And, you know, and that's really what it amounts to. What did you do to these people? And what is being done? You know, when we talk about the records today, what is going to be done with all those phone records and everything? This is what's going to be done with it. Any other questions?
Yeah, I have a good question.
No.
Okay, there's FBI files on people. Are there also separately other government files on people and state files on people, and you see where I'm going.
Yeah, in every state, that's why they call these red squads. They're under the direction of the FBI, and these red squads consist of the FBI, the state police, like in Minnesota it would be the Highway Patrol and the Public Safety Commission, and then the local sheriff's departments and the city police. So that's what these red squads consist of. And they do this, you know, all over the country.
Cool.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
This is our guest speaker today, Coleen Rowley, who is a veteran of the FBI and is engaged with Twin Cities Peace Movement. And thank you for coming, Coleen.
Yes, thank you. Albert Maki was in really good company. He had the smartest man of the last century, Albert Einstein, who died with an 1,800-page file. The people who were targeted, of course, one of the big factors are wars. So when the Cold War Alan Maki talked about being labeled a communist. Well, who was the enemy in the Cold War? It was the communists. So you had the House on American Activities. It started even before that. But when that got ratcheted up, J. Edgar Hoover, whose greatest fear was of communists, he saw them behind every tree, especially later in his life, was feeding the information to McCarthy. And, of course, you had exactly right. It was all guilt by association. One funny story, and I love talking about what happened in the 50s and the 60s into the early 70s, because this is unfortunately all re-happening now in slightly different ways. And this is the thing to be really, really, you know, our polls, we do not have enough Americans who understand this. There was a lull, a little bit of a lull, between the end of the Vietnam War, where certain remedies and fixes were the Church Committee and the Pike Committee heard stories like this. Some judges probably got mad and yelled about it, and the Church Committee, Frank Church, did a pretty decent way. He ended black bag jobs that the FBI, some of the recordings probably were things like happened to Martin Luther King. They were called, a black bag job was the term, and it wasn't totally illegal, because there was no law that prevented J. Edgar Hoover from breaking into places, planting microphones, and doing all of this spying, you know, wire intercepts. The fixes, the legislative laws occurred in the criminal field. It was called the Title III Law. I think it was 68 or so. Then after the Church Committee, the FISA, Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, because they were pinning everything on security. And again, this is the same thing repeating now. So, and they actually, the FOIA came on about that time, the Freedom of Information. That's why you got your file. Because, so there were some of these fixes that occurred, and then there was this lull. And, you know, people say, how could you work in such a terrible FBI? And this is not to say that there were no problems and no abuses and no mistakes. But in between the end of the Vietnam War and the beginning of the new one, it was a completely different situation. And when you get this national security state, the war, as I'm positing today with our NSA, it's the authorization to use military force. That's what they are rooting the authority for the spying in. And so so going back, Einstein, just to detail this a little bit, I was the FOIA officer for 13 years in the FBI towards the end of my career. But before that, when I was just a brand new agent, in Jackson, Mississippi, I was sitting at my desk, and the legal counsel in that office walked by, and he was like, oh, I need help, I need help. The National Lawyers Guild had won their lawsuit against the FBI, and this was about 82, I guess it was. And so all these FBI agents had to go back to headquarters and pour through the files and with their black markers in connection with that lawsuit. Well, in Jackson, exactly the same. There was a stack of files like this, and this one poor guy was supposed to go through it and then process it for FOIA, so I volunteered to help him. I only had a year and a half in. And I started, of course, I was out of law school, I started looking at those files, and it's exactly, I haven't seen yours, but this is exactly what it amounts to, this guilt by association. So the agents, I have to say, this is good work. If you think about how dangerous a work could be if you're going after a violent criminal who's, you know, killed 10 people, what would you rather do? Would you rather follow Alan Maki around and find newspaper articles to post in a file? There was actually a thing called post and float. That was the little thing, okay? So most agents do not prefer dangerous hard work. And they, as long as you had, well, no, it's not funny. It's human nature. No one would want to. So if you had a document in your files, it was how many files you had opened, and then you put new documents every week, the supervisor would check that you had filed some new documents, and then you got to collect your salary. You got promoted. You got all these things. They build incentives into the system. The other story I like to tell is about poor Pete Seeger. Pete Seeger gets called into the House on American Activities, and he was labeled a communist the same way. By the way, you know, won all these awards for music and everything else. It looks like one of his friends, Burl Ives, Jimmy Crack Corn, grandfather, ratted out his friend Pete Seeger. Most of your Hollywood people, because they were pressured that they were going to lose their careers. And so Burl Ives, you know, he would never have had another hit. That's exactly right. They could destroy people who were not, who didn't rat out their friends. And so there were only a couple of people in Hollywood who did not, sing, cough, whatever it is, even if it was their friends. That's what the House on American, it lasted, people think, oh, well, it only lasted 2-3 years. No, it continued on. And in fact, what happens is there's almost a seamless blend from the 50s. A lot of this, by the way, I learned this from reading this Einstein file. This is a very interesting. The reason Einstein probably did not make it onto the, what's it called that builds the bomb? It's the project, the Manhattan Project. Probably the reason he didn't make it on, even though Einstein was the one who suggested they build the weapon, was because of this file that Hoover said he can't be trusted. Again, same thing, communists. The information in Einstein's file was they always get it from your enemies. And so some of the Nazis that, of course, hated Einstein were the sources for him being called a communist. I mean, real reliable, right? It's the Nazis who you're trusting. And this was after the World War II, even. After World War II, our sworn enemies, the Nazis, were giving information on Einstein. There's a seamless transition, and it goes right into the 60s, where you have first the civil rights force, and then the anti-war feminists, who else were targeted. But the other groups, the student groups, et cetera, and they were all seen as dangerous. I just gave an interview to somebody on a radio, and I said, you have to understand, I was talking about WikiLeaks and Julian Assange, because now people, of course, think he's some horrible, you know, threat to the United States. Martin Luther King, who won the Nobel Peace Prize, and now we have a federal holiday, and nobody ever says a bad word about Martin Luther King. They sometimes misunderstand what he was doing, but it's because they emphasize only the civil rights and not the anti-war stuff. But he was exactly in the position of Julian Assange. Hoover thought of him as public enemy number one. And in fact, he was doing black bag jobs in his hotel rooms. They were blackmailing, trying to blackmail. They weren't too terribly successful with Martin Luther King, but they tried to blackmail Martin Luther King. Ultimately, talk about disruption, because they went this extra step, which was not just collecting information. As Alan said, they were the COINTELPRO, counterintelligence program, took the extra step of disrupting groups. And it was obviously based on sometimes political beliefs and et cetera. It was supposed to be tied in with violence, but it was also based on political. They actually said they could disrupt groups. So they planted infiltrators. In some cases, the person who was leading the group would have been an FBI informant. Marv Davidoff, you remember him? Marv Davidoff, who died a year and a half ago. He got his file. And I think one of the funny stories he tells is that he recalls, it might have been Students for Democratic Society, but it was a meeting like that. I think it was during the Vietnam War. And he recalls this meeting where he and another guy were all excited that 10 people had shown up. And so they were all happy because they didn't have that many people usually show up. When he gets his FBI file later on, he finds out that 8 of the 10 were all spies. You know, and I kind of make jokes about this, because this idea about it being infiltrated and being spied on, there's nothing you can do about it. The truth is, you will never, the case of Darby and whatever, it's almost always going to be like that case with the Molotov cocktails. It's going to be your best friend. Or Burl Ives and Pete Seeger. It's going to be like that. It's not going to be the dirty person that you always suspect. I mean, I got to tell one personal story really quick. In the lead up to the RNC, Republican National Convention, in Northfield, Minnesota, about 2 weeks before the RNC, the public, the group down there, the peace, they're called the People of Goodwill and Peace, something like that. A PPG, they had a thing. They had a meeting in the library, And Sarah Martin from WAM went down to talk about the march. I went down to talk about the peace picnic. The Vets for Peace were there. Who else? The group, the RNC group was there too. I forget
the
their name.
Committee.
The Welcoming Committee. Somebody was there from there. So we all took our turns in talking about, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have a picnic. We're going to have a march. Okay. In the back, when I get my turn, I see this. I didn't notice it at the time. This guy is crouching behind a woman. And I'm talking, there's only about 35 people that showed up for this. You know, some great conspiracy to take over the world at the RNC when there's 35 people in a public library. Well, this guy that was hiding behind this woman turned out to be a Bloomington police officer who was spying on all of this pre-RNC. And the reason we know it is he later wrote a book. And he even, now he's kind of an anti, well, he's written an op-ed against the war. So he's actually kind of even agreeing that this was, he was against the war and everything, and he thought it was kind of funny even. And the reason is he thought I'd recognize him because he was on our Joint Terrorism Task Force. And so he was hiding back there because he thought of, I didn't see him really carefully anyways. So that's been going on already now for some time. I wanted to make a couple of comments that I think are just really important about, okay, terrorists is now the term, so you can just substitute. It's terrorists now instead of communists, but it's almost on all fours. There's a complete, whatever you want to call it, the dichotomy, irony between the government, their secrecy is skyrocketed. 92 million documents are classified secret. So, for instance, if you want to get your NSA file, not your FBI file, they're denying all. NSA denies all. I mean, we all have, they say, hundreds right now of records in the NSA. They're meaningless because there's trillions. It's like a haystack of things. So I don't know why you'd want to see it in the first place. But if you do try to make your request to the NSA, it's going to be denied because it's all classified. And you even see the ridiculous extremes they're going to now. They're so afraid of a Bradley Manning that they're telling our government employees to spy on each other. This was the total information awareness that John Poindexter originally proposed after 9/11, that they would sign up as informants, your postman, your FedEx, and besides all of this massive electronic collection, that they would have people all over, you know. I mean, what does this remind you of? I mean, you know, obviously what we used to hear about the Soviet bloc and whether it was true or not. I mean, but this is what Poindexter's idea was. It never ended, by the way. Everybody thought it ended, and it just morphed and it went underground. So now you get to this, the government is calling the Insider Threat Program. So you don't have to be an outsider. You don't have to be labeled a hippie or an Occupy. Now you're going to also be spied on too. But even the poor people, you can talk about how paranoid. They are probably, I'm assuming, if I can just remember, they're probably even afraid to put a suggestion into the suggestion box. Because now they can be pointed at as a disgruntled employee because of the fear of the insider threat. I mean, this is, in terms of government, it is absolutely insane, and it's completely counterproductive what's going on. But the government secrecy is up here. Individuals' secrecy, which is what we call privacy, there is not to be any privacy. So everything about you is to be known. And the only thing with the NSA databases right now, and maybe Dan will correct me, I don't think they're very, they don't serve much of a purpose because they don't have biometric data in them. So if your name is a common name, Jane Smith, you know how many Jane Smiths are in there? And if they do not have your fingerprints or your facial scan or your what they're trying to get now is iris and all this, if they don't have that and you have a common name, even if you were a so-called terrorist, how would they be able to identify you? They can't. They have a complete mess. They have trillions of pieces of data. So when I write articles, I try to explain how this doesn't even work. It's actually hurting. It's like putting hay on the haystack. And you see, like in Boston, the bombing in Boston, one of the explanations for why they did not home in on those brothers, because Russia had given them a tip that they were related to the Chechen terrorists. Why didn't they do it? They were going after the Boston Occupy. They were spending, they were actually, you can see they got the files, they were spending a lot of time. So I think it's dumb what they're doing, and I try to explain this to the average American. I'm jumping way down here, because the polls right now, the real challenge we have is not so much with our politicians, although they're another challenge. It's actually now with the American people. The American people, the latest polls I just saw before I came here, are like 54% now are siding with I want you to have all my phone data because I want to be safe. Obama's speech the day after Snowden's revelations were, his quote was, and of course, see, this was completely opposite of what he said when he was a candidate. When he was a candidate, he said, the choice that between liberty and security is a false choice. That's what he said. That's what our founding fathers said. That's what Obama said as a candidate. After Snowden's revelations, he went out in front of the cameras and he said, I don't know how you expect me to give you 100% security if you want your privacy and your convenience. Privacy and convenience. Well, I'll tell you what, this is a lot more than privacy and convenience. Privacy, yes, it is privacy, but it's a lot more, and it goes to a lot of what Alan Maki was talking about. This is freedom of press, freedom of speech, and freedom of thought. It's our entire First Amendment now on the line. The dumb American, average dumb American who is one of those 54% who thinks that their phone data should be gathered up by the government. If you're one of those people, you just think, well, so what? It's just my privacy, and so what? You know, I go through the scanners nude, so I guess, you know, what's the difference? So if you believe that, and you believe that it is helping your security, you're always going to let it happen. But this actually now is putting First Amendment right on the line. One of the ways this is happening that the journalists, the reporters who report are being targeted themselves as spies under this Espionage Act. These crazy old laws that they pull out, they dust off during wartime. I have a friend who is writing articles about the law of war. The law of war is now supplanting the rule of law. And these old law of wars go back, the worst egregious examples go back to the Civil War. In the Civil War, Lincoln allowed generals to shut down the Washington newspaper, put their editors in jail. He did the same thing with the Chicago paper. Because why? Because they were criticizing him. And you see the law of 1917 Espionage Act that they're using to prosecute whistleblowers, it goes all the way back to World War I. This, I think Eugene Debs did 7 or 8 years in prison for the same thing. There's a law that's passed in 1918, the Sedition Act is 1918. But the 1917 one has a chapter in the 50s under when the House Un-American Activities, and it's called Espionage, I think it's called Espionage, the chapter title is called Espionage and Censorship. That's on the books. And of course, it was not used. After the Civil War, when Lincoln used these great abusive powers, there were a couple of cases, and people thought it was over. After the war ends, some of this power was repudiated, and people thought that these laws were, well, now they're all coming back. The laws that they're citing in the Guantanamo briefs right now for the detainees are pulling out these old Civil War precedents that you cannot criticize because it hurts the morale of the troops. And these are all, when this is all written, because it's being published right now, called How the Law of War is Being Subverted. And it's when this is published, you got to read it because it's how freedom of the press and freedom of speech and freedom of thought ties in. And otherwise, people want to, and it ties in with this war suppression. the guilt by association is ridiculous. Milgram did that famous, he's a long dead social psychologist, but he kind of proved that we're all 6 degrees connected. So, and it turns out it's less than that, 6 degrees. So in this vast NSA gathering thing, when they put their programs in, their computer programs, first of all, I don't see any proof that a computer program can do what they're misleading the country to believe, that they can find the terrorists by putting in these programs that are, you know, looking for certain numbers, looking for certain words, etc. And the truth is, everybody's connected very, very closely. In the United States, it's usually 2 or 3 degrees connected. So how in the heck can you do this? The National Academy of Sciences say it's not possible. If the American public understood that none of this is working, it's harming and hurting our beloved national security. This isn't helping. This is hurting. Yesterday, the new FBI director, I have an op-ed in the New York Times on Tuesday, and it was about questions that this new FBI director should be asked by the senators, because that his name's James Comey, he signed off on waterboarding, he signed off on sleep deprivation under Bush, he signed off on warrantless monitoring in 2005, this whole, and he signed off on the third one, Fourth Amendment was monitoring the torture and, due process. Due process is 800 years old. It goes back to the Magna Carta. He is a strong proponent of holding incommunicado an American citizen for over 2 years without an attorney in a brig and using some of these what they call enhanced tactics in order to try to get information. And he actually said he stands by that. He's going to be the new FBI director. Almost certainly he's going to be the new FBI director. I wrote an op-ed, I was on Democracy Now this morning about it, because if the American public knew any of this, they control the media, they control a lot of things, but if they knew their tax money was huge amounts of tax money. The NSA thing is, there's 3,000 agencies, private agencies and public ones. These private contractors are working hand in glove with the public agencies. There's Top Secret America, there's 3,000 of these. Your tax money is going to spy on you. No, we were all misled in the war. War is a good propaganda because it uses fear and hate to believe it's on others. And as long as you think this is happening to Pakistanis and Afghans and Libyans, then you're okay with it. When you realize it's focused on you, now the thing changes. And actually now, you know, about half of Americans, it's exactly, the polls show it's almost half and half. So I think it's probably the best chance we've had for in recent days. I told people on my news interviews that we should call, because the congressional record's open till Friday. And so all of these issues, we should be calling up our senators. The truth is, I mean, I'm no advocate of our elected politicians, but they don't get calls from people. And maybe people have just given up. If you have a better idea, let me know. We have fusion centers. The new red cells are the fusion centers right now that they're doing the same thing, collecting information. I got one quick paragraph. This is by Andrei Sakharov. When we see this abroad, we see an Alan Maki or an Albert Einstein in a foreign country, we consider them the greatest hero in the world, right? So we do just the opposite, unless they're Bradley Manning and it's us or Edward Snowden. So this was Sakharov's, published in 1968 at about the same time. He wrote, the second basic thesis is that intellectual freedom is essential to human society. Freedom to obtain and distribute information, freedom for open-minded and unfearing debate, and freedom from pressure by officialdom and prejudices. Such a trinity of freedom of thought is the only guarantee against an infection of people by mass myths, which in the hands of treacherous hypocrites and demagogues can be transformed into bloody dictatorship. Freedom of thought is the only guarantee of the feasibility of a scientific democratic approach to politics, economics, and culture. Whoa.
Thank you so much, Coleen.
investigation has to be closed. And so once it's closed, if it's classified, you actually almost have to go into court and fight, especially now, because the presumption, when I was working under Janet Reno, they had a presumption we were supposed to release the file unless we could actually worry that it would do some kind of harm. So the presumption was, and people didn't have to go into court. The presumption switched, and now the presumption is you should withhold it, and you'll probably have to go. And you can do this on your own. You don't need a lawyer to fight in court. But they will not, if it's classified, you have to first seek declassification. And usually the rule is 25 years, something like that. But you can get something declassified sooner than that. And probability is it's not classified, but it's hard to say.
Well, you can get, even if there's an investigation in progress, they will deny your initial Freedom of Information Act request on the basis of an investigation in progress, and they do that all the time with me. But the way you get around that is when you go into court, if you can argue that it's hurting you, a judge will open it up, and that's what happened in both of my cases. The judges opened it up because there was enough evidence there to say, you know, this guy is no criminal, why are you doing this to him, and what has been done, let's see what you're doing. And many of those files there, we got within 6 months. They continually argued that there was an investigation in progress and they needed time to continue the investigation. And the judge says, you know, you've had plenty of time. Some of these people have been walking around 30 or 40 years and they're still walking around. They're not in jail. What kind of investigation are you carrying out here? Then one thing here in Minnesota, I don't think that we realize and appreciate, the Minnesota Farmer Labor Party, the original Socialist Minnesota Farmer Labor Party of Elmer Benson, Floyd Olson, John Bernard from Eveleth, who was the congressman, the Martin Dees, they had the Dees Committee, and that was like the predecessor to Joseph McCarthy's House on American Activities Committees. Well, the Dees Committees, their first actions were taken right here in Minnesota against the Farmer Labor Party and to crush the Farmer Labor Party. That was back in 1936, they started this investigation, and by 1938, the Farmer Labor Party had been practically crushed. And the Farmer Labor Party was the most successful third party movement ever in this country, and we hardly ever hear anything about it anymore. You know, we should be learning from this movement. The government doesn't want us to know about it.
Do they ever pressure family members to give information on other family members? What types of things could you expect? I have reason to believe that they may be applying some economic pressure to people that are related and unrelated to me, that I'm responsible for their care and so on. So.
Well, the answer to your last question is certainly. They'll apply pressure to anybody that they think has information. One thing about these old files is unless you were historically important, if the files, and unless you got them yourself, in many cases they're gone. So these real interesting things have been destroyed in connection. Part of it's just storage. They don't have the rooms to store this paper files. So now it's about 7 years. If you robbed a bank, you would have a file, but eventually that bank robbery file, I think it's around 7 years, will be destroyed. So if you had an old file. Now if you have something now, it's easy to make your request. You just send it in. The only thing is, and if you are not important, if you're not Martin Luther King, I mean, in a way you should wear this as a badge of pride, because they only really care, and they would only do these extraordinary things if they think you're important. If you are really, you know, Martin Luther King, Julian Assange, posing a threat to them. We joke about, well, they're going to stop you, they're monitoring you. Well, they won't do that unless they care about you. And, you know, you have to actually be on their radar. Otherwise, you're just going into that system along with almost everybody. Every single person is being collected.
There were articles, like, prior to the 2012 election, you know, prior, basically when Occupy got evicted nationwide, there were articles coming out like, oh, this is a coordinated effort between the NSA, the FBI, the CIA, whoever. Everybody was saying that's a conspiracy theory. The Democratic Party has a little arm called the Labor Union Movement here in Minneapolis. Occupy Homes was that arm. Does that sound right? I mean, does that sound like, would the FBI, the CIA, that's annoying.
I'm just trying to turn it up.
I mean, would the... Is that paranoid to say that they were working with local mayors like R.T. Ryback to violently squash the Occupy movement through local police departments? Is that reality based?
Sure. I was at the RNC demonstration. I was walking next to R.T. Ryback.
Yeah.
And I think it was his, I don't know, I never met his wife, but he was walking with a woman. I assume it was his wife. Mm-hmm. And we were going through this like gauntlet of the police all dressed up in their black uniforms and beating their clubs and everything. And she turned to him and says, "My God, what kind of beast have you brought into our community?" Mm-hmm. And you know, these people know exactly what they're doing, and it's intentional to try and intimidate and harass and suppress any kind of developing movements. That's their intent. And when they can't do that, then they infiltrate them and disrupt them. I guess a
related question is, you know, there have been recent reports about assassination attempts or some kind of plan within the FBI to assassinate leaders within the Occupy movement. I'm sure a lot of people here have heard about that. How many have heard about that? Okay. If you could comment on that, I'd appreciate it. Either of you.
I think what I read was that there's a document that shows that there were assassination information about this. It wasn't that it was the FBI. The blame was that the FBI did not warn or did not disseminate that information that they got. When I worked in the 80s in New York City, and of course I worked on mob, organized Italian crime that were constantly plotting to kill the other families and stuff. And we were supposed to, at the time, I have no idea if this ethic still exists, we were supposed to warn if we got information about a victim of an assassination from another family. Mm-hmm. But we also didn't want to give up our case, because if we went to warn somebody, then they would be, they'd be on to the fact that we were doing it. So they found some creative ways to do these warnings. So I don't have any idea if that ethic, I think it's a good ethic, because, you know, obviously if you have that information, you should be using it to prevent further violence, but.
Could it be said that President Obama ordered the violent eviction of the Occupy movement in a coordinated fashion? All at the same, because it was happening in cities all around the country at the same time. Was that coordinated, or?
You know, my guess, because I'm long out and stuff, but my guess is that the certain fusion centers and joint terrorism task forces, they integrate all, they're like the old, what they called the red cells. They integrate state, local, and federal. And in the lull period, we were very careful, the FBI was very careful not to mess with protest marches. Mm-hmm. That was actually part of the fix that the church committee, they said, well, your FBI, that's not a federal law. There's no federal law involved in riot and these types of things. The state and local were supposed to work on protest type issues. But what happened after 9/11, very quickly, they integrated, for instance, in New York City with that spying on Islamic people, they had the CIA involved in that. The CIA was involved with the New York PD. The CIA is not supposed to even be involved domestically. But how they get involved? They got involved with this big, whatever they call them, terrorist task forces.